नमस्कार, एएनएम न्यूज में आपको स्वागत है। और एएनएम न्यूज की एक खास पेशकश एएनएम की अड्डा, उसमें आज हमारे सामने है यहाँ के एक बहुत बड़ा हस्ती। अगर आपके पास कोई कंपनी है, लेबर से आप रिलेट करते हैं, तो साफ से मिलना ही पड़ेगा। अक्षय काला जी, एम्प्लॉई स्टेट इंश्योरेंस कॉरपोरेशन की रीजनल डायरेक्टर, नमस्कार। एएनएम के अड्डा में आपका स्वागत है। अक्षय काला साहब, आपका तो बहुत दिन हुआ नहीं कलकत्ता में, तो कभी जब आप पढ़ाई करते थे, व्हेन यू यूज्ड टू स्टडी इन स्कूल, डिड यू एवर थिंक दैट यू विल एवर बी पोस्टेड इन अ प्लेस कॉल्ड कोलकाता?
नो, फ्रेंकली आई नेवर थॉट दैट आई एवर वुड बी पोस्टेड इन अ प्लेस कॉल्ड कोलकाता। कोलकाता एज सिटी ऑफ लेक्स वॉज समथिंग दैट यू आर सपोज टू रिमेंबर, because this could be one of the questions in you know your competitive examination. So that was one thing. Secondly, a majority of the medicos in my town, the doctors, were from Bengal, whether Dr. Banerjee or Dr. Kar. So I used to ask my mother that we have 2-3 doctors in the town. It's a very small town, sleepy town called Kodwara in Uttarakhand, and population of around 20-25,000 during those days, early childhood days I am talking.
ये कितना दूर है देहरादून से?
देहरादून से ये 3.5-4 घंटे का रास्ता है, not very far off.
In the hilly place?
No, it is in the foothills. Kodwara means from Kodwara only the hills start. That is how it is. So then I asked some of the people who are in medical profession in my family. They said that Kolkata is the place where we had the largest 4 or 5 medical colleges when we got independence. So that is one reason that you are finding many people from Bengal who are working as doctors. So these are only 2 instances. Even after joining ESIC, you will be surprised to know that I am working in ESIC since 1996.
Mm-hmm.
Till 2019, I never visited Kolkata. Forget about Kolkata, eastern part of the country I haven't seen. कुछ अंदाजा नहीं था। कोलकाता पहली विजिट पोस्टिंग के बाद ही भी है। कोलकाता के एयरपोर्ट में उतरना मतलब जब यहाँ का चार्ज मिला उसके बाद ही।
सो व्हेन यू आर अ चाइल्ड एंड यू स्टडीड, यू गोइंग टू कॉलेज, स्कूल्स एंड कॉलेज, सो यू डिड यू ड्रीम ऑफ बिकमिंग अ सिविल सर्वेंट?
नो, ड्यूरिंग दोज डेज, वेल आई वुड पुट इट दिस वे, since my town was small, it didn't have any English medium school. My mother was very keen to see to it that, you know, we go to an English medium school. So I was posted, I was sent to a boarding school. The place is called Lansdown. It's a hill station.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah, it's a cantonment hill station, and it was near my hometown Kodwara. So I studied there from 1976 to 1980, from 6th standard to 10th standard. So that was one reason that I was sent to that place. And then it was all the fun and frolic. Sometimes you used to study and there was not much of a pressure from my parents' side also. So becoming a bureaucrat or joining any kind of service, that was the only dream. Nothing great that I would one day become a bureaucrat and, you know, would be serving in ESIC. That was not even thought of.
So Ismail, how did you join this organization? How does one come into this organization?
Well, to some extent, I would say I had been very lucky, because if you look at the country during those days or even today, getting a job is supposed to be a dream for a majority of the people who graduate. So I graduated in the year 1985. I did my BSc from Government PG College, Kodwara, and 28th April 1986, I joined a regional rural bank as a probationary officer. I worked there till 1996, more than 10 years. In the interregnum, there was an advertisement of UPSC in employment news that there are certain vacancies in ESIC, 36 vacancies to be precise, and I applied for that. Then there was a written test followed by an interview by UPSC. Luckily for me, they didn't ask me anything about ESIC because I was zero as far as ESIC is concerned, because typically when you are born and brought up in a place which doesn't have any industry. I mean, Uttarakhand during those days, there was no industry. It was not a state. It was a part of UP. And we hadn't even heard of ESIC. Even after qualifying my written test, I consulted with some of the professors of the college, whether they know about ESIC. So they said, no, they are not aware. And luckily, during the course of interview, no question was asked to me about ESIC. They asked me about banking, about rural assignment, about Uttarakhand. So it was a cakewalk for me. It was not very difficult. So that is the way how I joined ESIC.
Is it the same system now? If somebody wants to join this organization, do you follow the same UPSC?
Yeah, for joining as a deputy director, as a group officer, you have to apply through UPSC. And then there is a written test followed by interview. That is how it goes, even today.
Age limit
is 40 years, because for 5 years experience is necessary. Okay. You need to have a 5 years experience in the supervisory capacity, and then only you can apply.
In any government job or a non-government organization?
No, in ESIC at least. Okay. In case of EPFO, there is no such bar.
Okay. No, the 5 years experience in any organization?
In any organization, whether it's a government organization or a private organization also.
Okay.
Yeah.
So once you're
as an executive. As an executive in supervisory capacity.
Then you join as
a deputy director. The hierarchy goes like deputy director followed by deputy director STS, then joint director, director, additional commissioner and commissioner. Okay. Above commissioner we have a director general. Generally, director general is an IS officer. So he too is of the rank of additional secretary. He's a pretty senior IAS officer.
तो अब तक आपके जो सफर रहे हैं ESIC में,
हाँ,
वो कहाँ रहा, कैसा रहा?
अब तक मेरा सफर बहुत अच्छा रहा. Surprisingly, one place where I have stayed the maximum in my life so far. Now I'm 54. So it was in Mumbai. 11 years stay. 11 years stay had, I mean, such a long stay had never been. No stay had been this long so far. Because initial 10 years in Kurdar till 5th standard, then Lansdowne 5 years, followed by 4-5 years again in Kurdar, and then in different places of Uttarakhand when I was working in the bank. And 1996 to 2007 it was Mumbai. That was the longest stay, I would say. Then 2.5 years in Nagpur, then 6 years in ESIC headquarters Delhi, followed by almost 2 years in HIC Medical College and Hospital Faridabad.
Right. तो इसमें जब मुंबई में जब थे आप, तो उसमें कुछ खास आपके कुछ अंदाज, लाइक यू नो, मुंबई इज नोन मोर एज अ फाइनेंशियल कैपिटल एंड सेकेंडली एज द मूवी टाउन, द बॉलीवुड टाउन. सो आपका वहाँ पे, बिकॉज देयर आर होल लॉट ऑफ इंडस्ट्रीज देयर इन मुंबई,
राइट,
एंड मुंबई इज कंसीडर्ड वेरी प्राइज पोस्टिंग. तो वहाँ पे आप, हाउ डिड यू सी द ESIC सिनेरियो देयर इन मुंबई? एनी एक्सपीरियंसेस?
There are many, actually, not one, two, because I used to read a lot of different kinds of magazines also. Our colony is situated in Andheri West, that is called Asik Nagar, and it was near Juhu Beach. So we were lucky that in the morning we could go for a jog. Then it was near ISKCON Temple, Prithvi Theatres was nearby, walking distance. Then the bungalow of superstar Amitabh Bachchan was nearby. Then Ramayan, the bungalow of Shatrughan Sinha, was walking distance. So all the filmy people were living there. Two to three experiences come to my mind. I won't name them because it doesn't look nice. At least one film star male and one film star who was a female. I have seen them begging in Mumbai.
Okay.
That is one. Secondly, the mills.
Begging matlab kahan pe? On the streets of Mumbai or
on the
beach?
On the street of Mumbai. Definitely.
People did not recognize them?
People did not recognize them. We discussed it with them, and then I could make out that yes, they are the film stars. So they both of them told that how things went horribly wrong in their lives, and you know how they were duped by the producers and so on and so forth. So these were the two persons. It doesn't look nice to name them, so I won't. That is one. Secondly, the mills, which were hitherto employing the largest number of workers in Mumbai, they were closed one by one. So it was a very saddening experience. I could make out even during those days that something wrong is happening. some golden handshake kind of thing was, you know, paid to the workers, which was approximately 1.5 to 2 lakh rupees approximately per worker. And some of them were pretty young, 35, 40 years of age. And the whole family, you know, had to suffer. And it was, we are not talking about one or two persons. We are talking about anything like 35 to 40,000 people who were, you know, made to suffer. And all these mills were disposed of, were sold. And the sleepy areas of Mumbai, which were earlier known as Lower Parel, where my office was located. And in a span of 3 to 4 years, the whole scenario changed. All those, we call it chawl. एक बैठी चौल होती है, एक खड़ी चौल होती है. तो चौल्स वर डिसमेंटल्ड एंड न्यू बिल्डिंग्स केम अप. द एरिया इज नॉट नोन एज लोअर परेल एनी मोर, दे कॉल इट अपर वर्ली. सो मेनी स्काई स्कैपर्स हैव कम, सो मेनी बिग होटल्स हैव कम, थिंग्स हैव चेंज्ड. आई मीन फॉर स्काईलाइन हैज चेंज्ड, द प्लेस हैज चेंज्ड कंप्लीटली. Either good or bad, I mean, it can be decided in the next 50 to 100 years.
That's only a difference.
That's a difference.
When you used to work, you're a young deputy director working in a big city like Mumbai. So, did you try to investigate defaulting companies in ESI, ESI defaulters, and did you face any challenges there?
There are many defaulters. The thing is, business is, it doesn't go the way we look at it, we perceive it actually. Sometimes even people with good intentions fail, and in our country during those days, slowly things are changing. Now we have bankruptcy code and all those sort of things, but bankruptcy was a stigma, I mean, during those days. I am talking to you in the early
80s,
late 90s or 2001 or 2002. Nobody used to declare himself as bankrupt, that is one. People used to fail, but they would never say it. I worked as a recovery officer, so I used to talk a lot to the people as to what has gone wrong. There was an industrialist who was into textiles. He inherited it from his father and he failed. So we had to recover anything like 16, 70 lakh rupees from him. And he said that if you force me, if you, you know, issue arrest warrants and all that, then I'll have no option but to dispose of a particular gala which is in my name. And if you force me, then I'll have to sell it for a loss. But if you give me some time, say 1 to 1.5 years, probably I will be able to, you know, square off the things. So we sat together for some time. He used to come to my office, we would have a cup of coffee and all. But he went on paying on a monthly basis. He said that I will come to your place with religious regularity on a monthly basis, I'll have your cup of coffee, and then, you know, I'll pay the money. So it went on for some time, and then his son, he was very keen to do something in the field of technology. So mobiles were being introduced in the country, and he came with the concept of gaming in mobile. And his son later on started a company, and he went on to do very well. It is called Nazara Technologies, and he's doing very well as on
that.
So now he survived, he's paid all the money. The only thing is that when you are working in a government department, you have to have an empathy for the person. It is not nice to say that you are on this side of the table and the other side of the table is a defaulter only, he's a thief, or if he's a businessman, he's a crook. It doesn't work like that.
Okay.
So it is better that you listen to the people. If people have good intention, then
give them a chance.
So in general, I used to get the money from almost all of them.
You had a good Now tell me about this Bollywood industry. They also had this PF and ESI.
No. During those days, there was no social security for them. Later on, they said that we are industry, we should also be given this facility. And I believe that it should be given to them, because you hear only about 3 or 4 mega stars, but rest of the people who are working hard, who were behind the camera, you know, that kind of thing, they should be given some sort of social security. So of late we have started it. Once they said that we want it, then we have covered some of them, and now some of them are getting ESI. And
but the entire industry is a huge industry with lots of thousands and thousands of people working directly and indirectly.
Definitely.
Especially in studios, they employ a big company. There's a big companies to RK Studios and other studios, they are big studios. So they don't have ESI facility to their employee.
No, they didn't have it because it was never thought to be an organized labor force. The organized labor force, by definition, what we mean is that देर शुड बी एटलीस्ट 10 persons who आर वर्किंग फॉर द कंपनी एंड देन ओनली दे गेट द बेनिफिट ऑफ ESIs. इन केस ऑफ PF आई थिंक इट इज 20 एंड probably ओनली इन द रीसेंट पास दे आर ट्राइंग टू रिड्यूस इट टू 10 और समथिंग एंड द सैलरी वी वेज लिमिट इन आवर केस इट इज 21,000. सो पीपल आर गेटिंग 21,000 और लेस देन दैट दे आर कवर्ड अंडर ESIs प्रोवाइडेड द नंबर ऑफ persons इज 10. इन केस ऑफ फिल्म इंडस्ट्री it was never ever treated as an industry actually. We call it film industry
but
it was not an industry.
Okay.
I mean as far as the definition is concerned of the government department, so they were not getting this kind of benefit. Actually it should be given to them because it's a very dicey kind of a scenario. It is very, once you are once you may be getting a very good money, but then suddenly if something goes wrong, then even some of the good stars, if you notice, even they are not getting much work. True. Unless they have a very good family background or they have good financial backing, it is difficult to survive. It's a very costly city as well, I would say.
So when working as a recovery officer in Mumbai and your long tenure in Mumbai, did you ever honestly feel any political pressure or pressure from the top to kind of?
Yeah, pressure is there. There is no doubt that.
इसको छोड़ देते हैं.
हाँ, it was an indirect pressure. What happens is that state government has a right to give exemption to certain companies.
In exemption मतलब?
Exemption मतलब कि if an employer says that he is providing same kind of benefit to the workers which ESIC is providing, then a state government can take a note of it and they can say that okay, it is exempted from ESIC, he need not contribute to ESIC. So generally it is easier said than done, because the thing is, if suppose I am having an industry having 50 persons and I say that I am providing similar kind of benefit, I may provide health insurance to my workers, I may have a private PF, then I should have sufficient reserves. If at all 10 persons die together, will I be able to give pensionary benefit the way ESIC gives? That is one. Secondly, the kind of healthcare facilities that ESIC is giving to the dependent of the workers, whether I am giving it or not, and if I have it, whether I have the financial resources or not. These are the things which should be looked into. But generally, these are not looked after, and as a result, the decisions are taken on some other considerations as well, it seems. In one case, we attached the shop. It was they used to sell expensive cars. We had to recover anything like 5 to 6 lakh rupees.
Okay.
So I said it is very easy, because the thing is, once you attach the business, then even if you attach one car, you dispose it off, then you get the money. So it was not very difficult. So I knew that it is not very difficult for me. Today I have attached it, tomorrow I will see to it that one car is taken from that place, and then we will come out with the advertisement, we will get it valuation done and so on and so forth. But next day itself, the representative of the company came and he said that they have got the exemption. And the company was not doing very well financially. So I knew if company is not doing very, very well financially, it doesn't have much of money in the bank, it is next to impossible for it to provide social security benefit to its employees. So that was one. Secondly, in another case, there was a famous chain of footwear business. They were into footwear business. I won't name it. They had connections. So we attached the account, we had to recover only 1 lakh rupees. So a gentleman came from their place, he said that they know the people and it is better that I mend my ways and all that. So I said okay, I'll see to it that nothing happens to you. And then he went away. Fortunately for us, the sufficient balance was there in the account, we took away the money. That was second. In third instance, there was a restaurant from which we had to recover 1 lakh rupees, 1.5 lakh rupees. So he came, sir, do you know, sir, kiska restaurant hai? Man ka nahi, mujhe to nahi malum kiska hai. So I wouldn't name it. It was in the name of the then chief minister.
Okay.
Then chief minister's wife.
Okay.
He said, ye CM sahab ki wife ka naam hai ye, aur yehi restaurant ka naam hai, aur aapne aisa kar diya. देन यू हैव टू बी टैक्टफुल आल्सो. आई टोल्ड हिम, सी 1.5 लाख रुपए के लिए इतने बड़े आदमी का नाम खराब मत करो, जमा कर दो, छोड़ो, कल कोई बात होगी, कुछ होगा, ठीक नहीं लगता है. तो दे डिपॉजिट द मनी. यू हैव टू बी स्लाइटली टैक्टफुल आल्सो, बट एट द सेम टाइम इट इज बेटर दैट यू डोंट शो एनी पावर एंड ऑल दोस. यू हैव टू बी स्लाइटली टैक्टफुल एंड डिप्लोमेटिक इन योर अप्रोच. बट प्रेशर इज प्रेशर प्रेजेंट.
And go for it. Sure. Thank you.
Pressure, it was not much of pressure was there. But sometimes if the other person will check your background, what kind of work you are doing and what kind of person you are, what kind of officer you are, definitely they check out your background.
No, but aapka mantra ye raha ki theek hai, mukhyamantri ki biwi ka naam le rahe hai, and some very big political pressure is coming, but I will deal it in a very tactful manner so that...
Right.
सब कुछ सही सलामत रहे.
हाँ, सब कुछ सही सलामत रहे. हाँ.
तो ये वो भी ना गुस्सा हुए और हमारे काम भी निकल आए.
करेक्ट.
ही डजंट आल्सो गेट एंग्री एंड ही आल्सो गेट अ जॉब. एट द एंड ऑफ द डे योर थिंग इज टू गेट द जॉब डन.
हाँ, डेफिनेटली.
सो व्हिचएवर मेथड इज इजीियर एंड फ्रूटफुल, यू वेंट अहेड विद इट.
डेफिनेटली.
दैट इज द मोर एंड विदाउट द पॉलिटिकल बिगर अप्स गेटिंग टू एजिटेटेड ओवर इट.
करेक्ट करेक्ट करेक्ट. दैट इज द वे हाउ इट शुड बी. दैट इज द वे हाउ इट शुड बी.
यू हैव मेंटेन द मुंबई एपिसोड. So ever did you ever get any tinge of regret about being in Mumbai? Well, I'm coming to Mumbai because that is where the big financial hub is, where the labor is, where the industry, everything is in Mumbai. India's everything in Mumbai, and you have served 11 years in Mumbai. That means there's been quite a big tenure.
So quite a big tenure, definitely. No, I never.
Any controversy, any shaking up, anything that you have?
No
regrets for.
There is no regret, definitely no, and there are. At least two reasons for this. One is that before I went to Mumbai, my mother had gone there. I have a very great influence on my personality from my mother because she was a good social worker. She did a lot for the family and she had a very terrific sense of humor. Many things are there. When she married, she was 12th standard pass and then she did graduation, then MA in Sanskrit, MA in Hindi, then B.Ed. एंड देन शी यूज़ टू से अगर लॉ खुल जाएगा कोटद्वार में तो मैं लॉ भी कर लूँगी. तो वी यूज़ टू जो कि हमने कहा लॉ करने की जरूरत नहीं, आप वैसे ही वकील हो, कोई खास जरूरत नहीं है. सो शी विजिटेड मुंबई वंस. सो शी टोल्ड अस दैट यू नो इट्स अ वेरी नाइस प्लेस. हमने कहा क्यों? देन शी सेड दैट देर आर स्पेशल ट्रेन्स फॉर वुमेन गो आउट एंड वर्क अ लॉट. तो प्रॉब्ली शी वॉन्टेड टू वर्क अ लॉट बट देर वर नॉट मैनी अपॉर्चुनिटीज. शी सेड मुंबई इज द प्लेस वेर यू हैव गॉट लॉट ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटीज एंड it gives fair treatment to the women. So that was in the back of my mind. That was one reason. Second was, even before I went there, my brother was also already working there. So 95 I lost my mother, 96 I got the job. So as a family we wanted to be together, and since my younger was there, so it was a big attraction for me. So that was second reason. Third was, it is culturally very vibrant. From July to December there are n number of festivals, and then the colony was in the right place. I have heard about Chandan Theatre because an episode took place there. Otherwise, it was not a crime-infested area, but something has happened in case of a young couple. And that was the reason that near Chandan Theatre, there was a Chandan Police Chowki, very small police chowki was opened. Because...
Achha, all these movie theatres that are there in Mumbai, they have got a sizable number of employees working for them, whole lot of them. So
right.
Were they covered under ESI?
No, if there are 10, then only...
Okay. Haan,
if there are 10, then only they are.
But
covered.
None of those Mumbai movie theaters are covered under this scheme.
No, if it is less than 10, it is not covered.
Okay. And what about the Board of Control for Cricket in India? That's also headquartered in Mumbai. Was it covered?
BCCI, I think it must be covered.
Did you had any case with the BCCI during your term shift in Mumbai?
No, there was no case with BCCI, but I think with the race course there was one. They said that, well, there is a definition of, first of all, there is a definition of factory, then shop, then establishment. Then establishment. So, there was some case, they went to the court. They said they are not, even clubs went to the court, Gymkhana clubs. They said, we are not covered, we are not a shop, we are not a factory. And
so, are clubs covered under ESI?
Now they are covered. Now. Then courts have given different verdict. They said, no, you are coverable. You employ people for wages and you are an establishment. So initially there were some cases where clubs said that no, we are not coverable.
अच्छा.
Generally people want to avoid it. That's the sad part because
ना इसमें ESI रहने से employee की सुविधा होती है. For any example, for any hotel industry or कोई भी कहीं पे भी, if they are covered under ESI, do you think that they genuinely get benefited?
Definitely, they generally get benefit. I have at least two examples before I came to Kolkata. I was working in Ahmedabad. One is the case of a hotel, I think it is Pride Hotel. One worker, he was working in the gym. So he used to come at 5:30 in the morning and then he suffered a stroke. Very young chap, around 28-29. And it proved to be fatal. So we gave benefit to his dependents, definitely, because we give dependent benefit to, it is almost 70% of the last salary which he is drawing, and then it goes on increasing the way D increases. So that is one case of a hotel. The other is related to a club where I was a member, a sports club in Gujarat. They had a librarian who was working for 16-17 years with them, and I used to go to the library on a daily basis after my gymming, so just to scurry through the newspapers and all that, and magazines. Then there was a small photograph on the glass door of library. It was his photograph. I said, what has happened? साहब ये तो दो तीन दिन पहले एक्सपायर हो गया. हमने कहा कैसे एक्सपायर हो गया? कर साहब पता ही नहीं चला, ये तो ये काम करके गया है और जैसे ही इसने स्कूटी पे किक मारी इसको चक्कर आ गई, गिर गया. एंड देन वी टुक हिम टू द हॉस्पिटल एंड देन 10-15 डेज ही वाज इन हॉस्पिटल, ही नेवर रिकवर्ड, देन ही पास्ड अवे. सो आई सेड इसका ESI करता था क्या? हाँ, ESI तो करता था. तो हमने कहा पेंशन देते हैं, मतलब दे डिडंट नो अबाउट इट. कहता पेंशन देता, अरे साहब ये तो बड़ा अच्छा होगा, उसकी तो बड़ी बुरी हालत है, उसके तो बच्चे भी कहीं भी सेटल नहीं हुए. तो देन वी प्रोसेस द केस एंड 16-17 ईयर्स ही वॉज वर्किंग. पीपल आर नॉट अवेयर, बट दे वर सो हैप्पी एंड सेटिस्फाइड दैट चलो यार कम से कम एटलीस्ट हिज फैमिली विल गेट समथिंग. सो दिस इज अ सेकंड इंस्टेंस ऑफ ए क्लब. थर्ड इज द इंस्टेंस ऑफ टॉलीगंज क्लब. देयर ऑल्सो ए वर्कर डाइड एक्चुअली इन द रिसेंट पास, ऑलमोस्ट टू थ्री मंथ्स बैक एक्चुअली, आफ्टर माई कमिंग टू दिस प्लेस. In that case also we have given the benefit, dependent benefit. So it is a beneficial legislation, people have to understand it. Yeah. It's a beneficial legislation.
इसमें दो चीजें, एक तो you have got a very good medical facility, ESI hospital के बारे में बात किया जाता है, and secondly, but one thing that often comes to my mind, because dealing with a huge workforce, so how do they do this? How do they go about getting the benefits? Now there have been often repeated criticism of agents, which often repeated called dalals, which you must have heard about, as the senior officer must have heard about complaints regarding that. So a lot of these dalals who work there, there are a lot of barriers before one can go through. There are a lot of kickbacks, a lot of underhand dealings. So how do you deal with this? How do people get through those barriers?
People can directly lodge a complaint with us. Nowadays it is very easy. Our mobile numbers are there in the website. We have our own website also. Complaints can be sent to PMO as well. Nowadays PMO is very active. If any complaint goes to the PMO, it has to be resolved within a week, and the highest working officer of the organization is taken to task. So there are many ways. The thing is, people have to come forward. Why they should go through the touts and why they should go to dalals for getting their things done, when there is a transparent method, why they shouldn't come to us? There are ways to complain. Nobody stops you from approaching any officer for that matter,
but in many cases it will appreciate that people are maybe uneducated, they are not very computer savvy, they are not very online internet savvy. In that case, what do they do? Do you have any help text or something where they can kind of go through it or make the entire process easier or something?
We have a help text, we have a toll free number as well, but the thing is, I think better course would be that we have as many meetings with a cluster of the people, and so that people get to know about it. That is not happening much. So we have plans to increase it. Yesterday only I had a meeting with one of the owners of jute mills. He told me that, why don't you come to our mill? Why don't you talk to my workers? So that was a very good thing on his part to say it, because I thought that owners would be the first hindrance, but here it was the other way around. He only was telling me, you come to my email and just talk to the people what kind of problems they are having. So probably it would be better on our part, it will be more appropriate that we go to such places on our own and talk to the people, we give our numbers to them. At least everybody can SMS it to me. If there is any issue, he can talk to us, he can send the message. So that way it can be done.
So the more awareness
is required.
Create awareness among the workers to
awareness
to kind of implement that. So far, what is the scenario in Kolkata? You have been here for some time. What is the defaulting scenario in Kolkata? How big are the defaulters list, and how much is the amount?
Defaulters list is pretty big, but then there are certain companies which were referred to BIFR, which went, you know, bankrupt kind of, and where even the bank loans are not being repaid and so on and so forth. So it is not as high as it was in other places, I would say.
So how do you kind of your this kebab? This Astor Hotel is known for its kebab. So this is a very special platter, kebab platter.
Okay, but I had my lunch only 1 hour back, so it is slightly difficult.
But
aap thank you. Madad karenge to hoga.
No, but this is government money, right?
This is government money. See, what happens is that we have a recovery mechanism. Recovery officer has all the powers. So generally what happens is that if you go ahead with the recovery proceedings, then the first thing that he will do is he will approach the court.
Okay.
He will say that, you know, he has been wrongly framed and the money that he is being charged is on the higher side, he was not listened to, person hearing was not given to him, and so on and so forth. So definitely court will give a chance to him to give up
his case.
To submit his written submission and all that. So now once the matter goes to court, then it may take at least 2-3-4 years. So it becomes difficult. Then it depends to a large extent upon the recovery machinery and the recovery officer himself. When I was working in Mumbai, then I remember in one case we attached a restaurant, bar and restaurant. It was around 3 p.m. an area which is known as Chembur in Mumbai. It was a bar. During those days it was known as dance bar. So there were many people inside, and we attached it, we closed down the shutter and put the lock, sealed the lock. Then they started shouting slogans. They said, on the one hand we are not getting any job, and on the other hand government is not letting us do our business. So I told them, see, we don't have any intention of stopping your business. Your things will start at around 10-10:30 in the evening. I have only 3 lakh rupees to recover from you. Even if you give me 1-1.5 lakh rupees, I think it was 2 lakh rupees. I said, even if you give 50%, which comes to 1 lakh rupees, before 10 o'clock, I'll open it. That's my promise. And this is my mobile number. So then we came back. At around 10:30 p.m. I got a call from them that they have arranged the money. Now we were returning actually, and it was Linking Road in Khar. From Khar to Andheri, it was a distance of around 6-7 kilometers. So I was accompanied with two inspectors. We got down from the bus, we took an auto, we came back, we decided a particular rendezvous where we could meet and check the money. He came at around 11 o'clock. We sat in a very seedy kind of a restaurant, and then he counted the money, gave them a receipt, sent an inspector and opened it. Because the thing is, had I not received the money that day, had I insisted for 2 lakh rupees, next day he would have gone to the court and got the stay. So it is always better that whatever you are getting, if it is significant amount, then it is better to receive the money. So that is one way of dealing, but then it depends to a large extent upon the recovery machinery. If the recovery officer himself is slightly
rigid.
Rigid, and if it is timid also, then too it is difficult. So there are many factors. There are many factors. So,
but all depends on your boss.
That all depends on the recovery officer at that point of time. Because as an additional commissioner, it is very difficult for me to see him on a daily basis, and talk to him on a daily basis. It largely depends upon him only.
Have you followed any such mechanism? Has anything cropped up here in Kolkata in your short tenure so far?
No, no. Kolkata, I haven't come across any kind of political pressure. On the contrary,
or have you been seized or sealed any hotel, shop?
No, we have not done it so far. Okay. We haven't done it so far. I have two recovery officers in Mumbai. One is in Barrackpore and one is in Grand
Kolkata.
One is in Kolkata regional office. So they haven't done it so far. Okay. They haven't done it so far. And that's what I am saying. It largely depends upon the approach of the recovery officer himself, because it is a separate office.
But then, do you feel that more Kolkata companies and Kolkata shop owners, hoteliers, they are more to more law-abiding? They are more
to a large extent. Yes, to a large extent, they are law-abiding. And one reason may be that workers are also knowledgeable, and it is not easy for the owner also to ignore them. So nowadays it has become slightly difficult. It is not easy for somebody to default. But political pressure, I haven't noticed. My tenure is pretty short. It is not the right moment for me to speak about it, because I joined only on 19 September. So it is only a few months time that I had been here. So once we started taking action, probably then only we will come to know. But generally, there are not many instances.
Not many instances. Okay. So we heard a lot about your fantastic experiences in Mumbai as well as in Kolkata, and it's good to see that and good to hear about it that you haven't had you haven't clamped down literally on any of the Kolkata.
No,
haven't had the opportunity to do that, because there hadn't been so many complaints against those.
No big defaulters.
But whatever the list are, you are trying your best to kind of.
In some of the cases, as far as jute mills are concerned, once in a while they close down the business for 2, 3, 4 months. They are defaulters, but they are in the court also. So, in many instances, wherever the default is on the higher side, the matter is lying in the court. So, I cannot take any action in those instances. So that is how it is.
तो हमने आपसे बहुत कुछ सुना, बहुत कुछ सीखा, बहुत कुछ जाना भी, खासकर मुंबई के बारे में, कोलकाता के भी बारे में. और ये हमारी खुशकिस्मत थे कि काला साहब हमारे साथ थे, अक्षय काला, एडिशनल कमिश्नर ऑफ ईएसआई. और इट्स वेरी हार्टनिंग टू नो दैट इफ एनी ऑफ द एम्प्लॉयज इन बंगाल एंड कोलकाता फेस एनी ईएसआई प्रॉब्लम, then they are free to knock at the doors of the local ESI office, correct?
Definitely.
Don't go through any doubts. Koi bhi problem hoga, to seedha senior officers in the ESI are always there to help. That's what Mr. Akshay Kala assured and promised us just now.
Definitely.
And do not take the help of any doubts. Shortly, ESI will come up with lot of awareness programs to educate the labor force onto the activities of the ESI and how ESI can is a close friend of yours and a friend in need, absolutely.
Definitely.
So that's what we heard from Mr. Kala. Thank you very much
for coming. Thank you.
And dekhte rahiye ANM News. Agle saptah fir hum log aayenge ek aise hasti ko lekar aur janenge bahut kuch iske bare mein. Dhanyabad. Namaskar.
Dhanyabad.